Good morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Arts Beat TV and Radio here on Westville Community Programming Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach, and we're headed up to the Berkshires to Berkshire Theater Group and my pal, Eric Hill. And as I was driving out to do Arts Beat today, I realized that Eric and I have worked together and known each other for almost 35 years when Eric was the artistic director and a leading force at Stage West in Springfield. So it's always, for me, a treat to get the opportunity to chat with Eric. Eric, welcome back to Arts Beat.
Thanks, Mark. Great to see you.
Great to see you, too. How has your summer been going? And Berkshire Theater has had a great summer.
So far, so good. Well, actually, the main part of the season is now concluded, and it was, considering all of the obstacles we faced, it was a great season. Yeah. We still have Nina on the Unicorn stage right now. It'll finish up this weekend. So, and then this show comes along at the end of September.
Now, the play that you're directing is called Shirley Valentine. It was written by Willie Russell, and I think it came out in the mid-1980s with Pauline Collins, and it was on Broadway, and then was made into a film. And if I recall correctly, it was done at Stage West with Anita Gillette.
That's correct. I produced it at Stage West. It was done, actually, in 1988, originally. We picked it up, I think, in 1990. So it's been all over 30 years since I've known this play and produced it 30 years ago. I think you were there when we produced it, weren't you?
I was not working at Stage West at that point, but I remember I was doing one of my first arts reporting gigs, so to speak, and it was one of the first shows that I actually covered as a reporter. I can't remember. Did you direct it or but you produced it?
I produced it. It was I think John Tyson directed it, and it did feature Anita Gillette in the title role. When I reread it for this incarnation that we're about to produce, I was really stunned at how well the play holds up 30 some years later. I mean, it's very poignant, and very funny, and still hits the mark. So I think, the sign of a really good play is a play that holds up over a period of time. And this one certainly does up until now.
And for people that don't know about it, it's sort of the story of a woman who is living a drab existence, and she goes off on a Greek holiday. She's a British woman and goes off on a Greek holiday excursion and returns completely changed.
Yeah, she's basically lives one of those anonymous lives in a endless row of semi-detached houses somewhere in the, you know, the outskirts she is under the sort of servitude of her husband Joe, she longs to escape her existence, and when her friend offers her a ticket to Greece, she willingly accepts it without Joe's permission or knowledge, and just shuttles off to Greece. The scene, actually, the second act is actually in Greece, and she does never return home, not to spoil the ending, but Joe does make an appearance that we don't see, but she talks about in Greece to try to retrieve her, and the consequences, the results are very interesting. The play really revolves around her inner thoughts. She talks to the wall in her kitchen, which is, of course, the audience is on the other side of that wall. And she talks to a rock when she's in Greece. But what we get is a very, very clear and very beautifully articulated look at the inner world of an obscure woman who has an incredible imagination and an incredible ability to articulate the realities of the world she lives in. And that articulation of what it means to seek your own freedom and your own sense of your own life, regardless of where you've been somehow planted by your circumstances. And that's the joy of this play. We also produced, when I was at Stage West, Willie Russell's other famous play, Educating Rita, about a young hairdresser from Liverpool who does go to college and attempts to educate herself. So Russell is always concerning himself with those individuals, those obscure individuals, particularly women, who find their own way based on their own intelligence and imagination, regardless of what the male world thinks of them. And I find that message particularly poignant still today.
Did you decide to revive this with the actress Corinna May in mind? She's the well-known in the Berkshires in the area, and she'll be playing Shirley Valentine. Did you think of her initially? Was she the inspiration, or was it just a great match?
It was a great match, but when I picked the play, I knew she was the person I wanted to work with on it, and she was very excited to do so. So yeah, it was just the fusion of when I was thinking of it, I thought immediately of her, and I didn't change my mind along the way. And I'm so delighted that she's doing it. I'm really looking forward to working with her.
Yeah, and you're doing this indoors at the Unicorn for a performance run. People should go to the website, berkshiretheatergroup.org. And the Unicorn's a small theater, so tickets are going to be limited and hard to get. So I would recommend that everybody jump online and get your tickets in advance. And I know that Berkshire Theater Group has been, throughout the season, looking after the well-being and the welfare of not only the audience members who attend, but the actors on stage and the people that work in the theater. So masks are required at this point, along with proof of vaccination. So keep that in mind when you order your tickets. Eric, for you, it's been a while since you've been directing. How does it feel to be back in the rehearsal studio?
Well, actually, I did direct this past winter outdoors, a show that you saw, I believe, Holiday Memories, that we did out in the sort of the quadrangle back behind the Unicorn in very cold weather.
Yeah, we both were there the same night, and Kate McGuire sent me home with one of those Berkshire Theater Group snow caps, which I wander around in the neighborhood with.
We were thinking about getting Berkshire Theater Group blankets as well, but we stopped short of that. But it was a great production. To answer your question, it feels great to be directing again. It feels good to be back indoors and a little bit more comfortable than I was sitting freezing directing the show outdoors. But I'm happy to be back, and I'm happy to be working with such a wonderful actress. It really does make my job a whole lot easier, considering it's a one-person play. The burden falls on her to do so much of the work, and my job is to really help her find her way towards the character.
You've had experience with Shirley Valentine before as a producer. Has Corinna May ever done the play before?
Not that I know of. It's been done at Shakespeare and Company, where she's worked in the past, but I think Tina Packer actually played the role once upon a time.
Yeah. It's a phenomenal role for an actress to take on, as I would assume any solo performance is. Have you ever done, as an actor, have you done solo work?
No, I never have. Never been really given the opportunity. And I find that kind of challenge particularly terrifying. I mean, you're out there all on your own, and in this case, it's a two-act play, so it's a lot of words. I have always tried to think of myself as a completely professional and a good actor, but I don't know if any audience would find me interesting for 2 hours by myself. But perhaps that's why I'm a director, is because maybe there's other people who are more interesting than I am for 2 hours. But no, I've never done one myself and never really had any interest, because I find that to be a particularly difficult form as an actor. Although as a director, I've worked on many one-person shows.
Yeah, I was going to say, as an actor, it must be terrifying because you don't have other people to play against. How do you, as a director, guide an actor in a solo show to keep focus for that entire 2 hour period of time?
That's a really, really excellent question, and that does become the challenge. In Shirley Valentine, there's a double chore at hand. She's not talking to the audience, as you get in many one-person shows, where there's some sort of relationship established where the actor is clearly talking to the audience. In this place, she's really not supposed to be talking to the audience. She's talking to the wall and then to the rock. I think that it is a very important thing for the actor to focus on something or someone to whom they are speaking at all times, even if they're not, speaking directly to the audience. So it's about an actor's internal process to keep a focus point that has a direct kind of connection and to whom the actor always addresses themselves. That's how the actor stays on focus, so that they don't get into sort of a wandering, sense of what's going on in their own mind. They keep the focus of to whom they are speaking, even if it's an imaginary object.
Yeah, I just think I would be terrified being on stage for 2 hours without another actor to play against, being in a monologue. It could be doing it on radio where you have a guest that just doesn't speak and you're carrying the ball. It's very difficult.
You've been there, right?
I have been there. I have been there, trust me.
Well, I don't present that problem. I talk too much. But you're hitting all of the problems that face any actor who's trying to perform in a one-person show. It's terrifying. And I think a lot of that is just controlling that anxiety by simply focusing on the person or object to whom you are speaking, and to just keep that connection and keep that focus. And that's the key. That's the key. In this case, in Shirley Valentine, she has to cook a meal while she's talking at the same time. So she has to fry eggs. She has to make fries, chips, they call them in England, set the table and have the dinner pretty much presented and done when she, at the end of the first scene. So that's quite a chore to talk and cook at the same time. So that's something, that's a fun challenge that we'll, present Corinna with, and I'm sure she'll answer the bell very, very, very well. In that case, doing little things will probably help her, because certain sections of the play will be, more clear to her because she knows what she's doing during that particular time. So there's a lot of little tricks that go on in the creation of a show like this for the actor to keep their sense of balance and where they are in their place.
How much rehearsal time do you get with a play like Shirley Valentine?
4 weeks, 3 weeks and a tech week.
And that's about the same time if you had a cast of 10, it would be about the same amount of time. Does working one-on-one with somebody, is that amount of time a luxury because you don't have distractions of other people in the cast needing your attention?
No, it isn't a luxury at all. For one person to have to, perform for 5 to 6 hours a day in rehearsal by themselves is hard work. So just getting on task and staying on task for the period of time rehearsal is a very large challenge. The line learning process is a big part of that. So my job is to be present while she sort of works through remembering the lines and doing what she's going to be doing at the same time. So no, it's not any easier than you would if you had 5 or 6 or 7 people on the stage to work with. It's just as hard.
And who are some of the creatives that are working with you in terms of designing the show?
I have my usual creative team, with the exception of my costume designer for the show, Olivia, I think it's Benunzi, is a new person for me. But I have my normal design crew working with me, Randy and Jay and...
And they must be excited to be working with you indoors rather than outside in sub-zero temperatures.
I think they are. Randy Parsons is he'll work in under any circumstances, and he did that outdoor set pretty much by himself, and he seemed pretty okay with it. The lighting designer, Matthew Adelson, not so much. And the sound designer, Jay, wasn't even there. We had the assistant there, and Jay's music was put in. So Jay Hagenbuckle. That's my normal crew. We've done a lot of shows together. They're happy to be indoors. We're happy to be working together. We haven't seen each other, really together for a while. So.
Yeah. We're going to take a quick break to acknowledge the underwriters that make Arts Beat possible. And we'll be back with more chat with Eric Hill from Berkshire Theatre Group. His play, Shirley Valentine, is the fall presentation at the Unicorn Theatre. You'll want to get tickets at berkshiretheatregroup.org. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach, and we'll return after we acknowledge the underwriters.
Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by Bay State Dental. Comprehensive dentistry at 14 convenient locations in Springfield, Chicopee, Longmeadow, West Springfield, Belchertown, East Longmeadow, Ludlow, Northampton, Greenfield, and Wilbraham, as well as 29 Broad Street in Westfield. Bay State Dental makes it a priority to help you achieve and maintain the healthy smile you deserve. On the web at baystatedental.com.
Support for community radio on WSKB provided by Westfield Electroplating. Employing over 140 skilled platers, painters, and technicians, Westfield Electroplating was founded in 1946 and was the first company in the country to achieve National Aerospace and Defense Contractor Program accreditation, proudly maintaining that status for over a decade. Westfield Electroplating provides over 50 quality finishes to meet your corrosion, cosmetic, or performance needs. On the web at www.westfieldplating.com or 413-568-3716. Westfield Electroplating, putting the finishing touches on technology.
Listen to me, Michael Buster McMahon, Mondays 8 to 10 a.m. to learn the stories behind your favorite songs. Or don't. I'm not the boss of you.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back to Arts Beat, everyone. I'm Mark Auerbach. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. My guest this morning is Eric Hill from Berkshire Theatre Group. If you missed a part of today's program or you want to rerun it again and again and again, you'll find it archived at WSKB Community Radio, along with all kinds of other programs we've done in the past. And one I'd hope that you'll want to watch in addition to Eric Hill is one we did earlier this year with the videographer Alex Hill, who happens to be Eric's son, who did this incredible documentary about the art heist at the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. Eric, that must have been a fun project. I know you had a walk-on in that.
I had a couple walk-on parts, and yeah, and we did a lot of the work at the Berkshire Theater Festival in and around the Berkshires. So yeah, that was a lot of fun, and my son is terrifically skilled videographer, and the work he does is really amazing. I'm really proud and astonished, but he's gone into a field that's related to ours, and he understands how production and producing works, but he's in an area that I don't know, and he's really good at it.
Well, one of the things he mentioned in the course of doing that particular interview, which was a real pleasure for me because I've watched him grow up and turn into this just gifted artist in a different medium. He said that growing up in a theatrical household like yours inspired him to seek out film and video as a tool, and he certainly has done very well with it. Besides Shirley Valentine, what are some of the things that you're contemplating working on down the road?
You know, that's a really good question, and I haven't really thought about it. I've been recuperating from a surgery that I just had. I had two discs replaced in my neck, so that was a major surgery only two months ago. So I'm just recovering from that. To tell you the truth, I haven't put much thought into anything but this project, because I knew it was looming at the end of my recovery. I'm sure as soon as the winter comes along and we have a little time to think about next year and what's coming up, I'll have some ideas. But right now I'm focused on Shirley Valentine, and I really honestly haven't put any thought to it. I'm sure there's some plays back there in the back of my mind I'm interested in. But I really am just focused on the present.
I was going to say that during the summer you were kind of like on your back, so to speak, for a while. Did you read plays or watch theater or do any of that while you were in recovery mode?
No, I didn't. I read murder mysteries, and I watched Netflix and other things on cable. No, I read. I saw no theater. I saw videos and great performances on television, but I did not in any way engage the theater. I was just thinking about recovering and keeping my mind occupied with other things.
And how are you doing now? Are you back up and running, directing? I'm sure directing a play takes a lot out of anybody. Are you thrilled by being back in the game, so to speak?
I am. The only problem I have is that sitting in one position for a long time is not the best thing for me at this stage of the game. And as a director, the one thing you do is sit in one place for a long time. So I'll probably, have a few chairs around the rehearsal hall and get up and walk around and sit in different chairs. And that may be a little angle of, a different twist. But other than that, I'm fine. I've been walking and getting out, and I feel fine. I feel better, because I was starting to become somewhat challenged by virtue of what was going on in my neck, and I was having pain in my arms and hands, and things were not as easy as they once were. So that has all changed, and so I have a whole kind of new physical life, and that's very exciting. So I'll go on long walks, and I'll think about all those plays that I have yet to do.
Yeah, I mean, I found that during my recovery mode a couple of years ago that I would do long, slow walks because I needed to, take my time. But being outdoors around here or being up in the Berkshires, there's just something rejuvenating about being in the woods and hiking. And it gave me a chance to recharge my creative instincts, so to speak.
Walking is the best. And in the Berkshires, there's so many. I mean, you can go outside and it's gorgeous. I'm just looking at my, the mountain behind my house here right now. There's so many beautiful walks in the Berkshires, and it's very, as you say, rejuvenating. So I do take advantage of that. I live in a gorgeous place.
So before we go, Eric, besides Shirley Valentine, what are some of the other things people can look forward to doing or seeing at Berkshire Theater Group in the next couple of months?
Right now, I think we're on a hiatus, although I don't know what's going on at the Colonial. We do have the tent still out behind the Colonial, and there are concerts that are there, and you can go to berkshiretheater.org and you will see the full lineup of those individual concerts that are still playing up there. But beyond that, we finish, as I said, Nina in the Unicorn this weekend. And then the next thing to come along will be Shirley Valentine.
Yeah, and then I understand White Christmas is coming to the Colonial for the holidays. And then in that January, February, cold winter period of time, what does Kate McGuire plan to have you direct outdoors?
probably South Pacific, I would imagine.
Something beachy, right?
Right. Well, I see South Pacific right over your
Yeah.
So that's inspired me, I think.
I think I will write a letter to Kate and ask her to consider that for the Stockbridge Bowl.
I think that's a great idea. Yeah. I think it's a great idea.
Eric, we're out of time. I want to thank you for joining me this morning. I can't wait to see Shirley Valentine, and more so to get a chance to see you. Our paths haven't crossed in a while, and it'll be good to have a little reunion. Get your tickets for Shirley Valentine by going to Berkshire Theatre Group's website at berkshiretheatregroup.org. They've got a lineup of concerts at the Colonial Tent and the Colonial Theatre, and then White Christmas is coming for the holiday season. All of that is available at berkshiretheatregroup.org. Thanks for being with us, Eric.
Thank you so much, Mark. Great to see you.
Take care. We're going to take another break to acknowledge underwriters, and we'll be back with more Arts Beats, so don't go away.
Support for Community Radio on WSKB is provided by Betts Plumbing and Heating Supply Company, an independent, family-owned wholesaler serving Westfield for over 50 years, specializing in plumbing, heating, and industrial piping supplies. On the web at BettsPlumbing.com or at 14 Coleman Avenue, in Westfield. Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Dunkin' Donut Shops of Westfield and the Sardinia family. It's nice to know that even as the world changes, Dunkin' Coffee remains the same at 7 convenient locations throughout Westfield. Support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by Bay State Dental. Comprehensive dentistry at 14 convenient locations in Springfield, Chicopee, Longmeadow, West Springfield, Belchertown, East Longmeadow, Ludlow, Northampton, Greenfield, and Wilbraham, as well as 29 Broad Street in Westfield. Bay State Dental makes it a priority to help you achieve and maintain the healthy smile you deserve. On the web at baystatedental.com.
Join us the third Wednesday of every month with Selectman Joe Deedy and his take on everything Southwick.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back to ArtsBeat, everyone. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. Peter Coles is our chief engineer. You're either watching us on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15, listening to us on 89.5 FM WSKB, or streaming us after the fact at WSKB Community Radio's YouTube page. My guest this half hour is David Horgan. He is kind of a Renaissance man. He's a filmmaker, he's an educator, he's an author, and we've known each other for a long time. We got to know each other through Berkshire Film and Media Collaborative. He's Springfield-based, and he's come out with a book that's kind of astounding because it's about a part of his career and life that a lot of us just weren't aware of. So, David, first of all, welcome. I think we've lost David. But
I think he's got to reconnect because his audio is not working.
Okay. We can take
it. There we go.
Here we go. Good morning, David. We
and
need
now you got to unmute.
Unmute, David. Can you hear us?
There we go. He's shut off.
You hear me?
I can hear you, but I can't see you.
There
can
we
you
go.
See me and hear me?
I can see you and hear you. How are you, David Horgan?
I'm good. Boy, you know, technology is a wonderful thing when it works.
When it works. I was just starting to say that you just came out with a book about a chapter of your life that a lot of us don't know anything about. So tell us a little bit about this new book that will bring all of us back to the age of the beginning of MTV.
Oh, gosh, yeah. I mean, that's actually where my career started. We did a music video. We were in Boston, just out of Emerson College. My partner, Scott Calvert, was still a student. So this is in the book. You know, we got together with a bunch of guys, had no clue what we were doing. we picked this band in Boston called New Man, which was like the hottest band at the time, and just ran around shooting these ideas, putting together this footage. A lot of it was unusable. You know, we had to do reshooting, etc. But somehow, when this thing was finished, we won MTV Basement Tapes, and the band got a record deal with Epic Records. It was our first music video.
Wow. And
crazy, right?
We should backtrack. What's the name of the book?
The book is called My Real Life, with the, you know, R-E-E-L, because it was, you know, basically about my life in the film business.
And you've worked with, in terms of film and music and videos, worked with so many people that are now well known. They're icons now, and they were just getting started when you took out your camera.
Yeah, we did the early Will Smith videos and New Kids on the Block. And then, you know, Mark Wahlberg was this kind of byproduct of the Wahlberg family. You know, we were filming New Kids on the Block in Los Angeles. And Donnie said, look, you got to do something for Marky. He's got his own thing. You know, he wants to be a rapper. You got to do a music video. So we shot that in Boston. That was the Good Vibrations. And that launched him. So I don't know. We just seemed to, you know, felt like we got lucky a lot, you know.
How many, can you estimate at this point how many music videos you did in those early years?
Probably about 30. Because, you know, they were grinding out music videos. MTV had the ability to launch these unknown artists. And it was a really interesting model because the record companies would pay $75,000 and say, do a music video, film in 1 or 2 days, you know. And then MTV would play the music videos and they didn't have to pay for programming. You know, you think about it, they had all this content that was being delivered to them for free. So it was a good model at the time.
And in today's music business, MTV is passé, and people seem to be putting their stuff out directly to video, like TikTok and things like that, where MTV is sort of a relic. But MTV changed the way that musicians got their music out there.
Yeah, and there were a lot of bands, I think, that never would have seen the kind of success they saw if it weren't for MTV.
The video sets you initially produced must have been relatively primitive to what we see today, but how did it evolve for you as a filmmaker?
Well, what was interesting is when we first started doing music videos, we felt compelled to tell some kind of little story. So those music videos typically follow, like we did this LL Cool J video, and he had to scale a building, break into it like he was James Bond, do a couple of Bruce Lee moves, you know, and then he finally comes down to this safe that he cracks, and when he opens it up, it's filled with hot girls, you know?
Yeah.
So that was like every rapper had, oh, I want to do something that's like a, you know, a kung fu movie. And they all wanted to tell stories. Whereas now, you know, videos, you see a lot more performance. You know, it was just more performance and dance.
Who are some of the ones that gave you the most leeway in terms of producing their video? Or did they come to you with this concept of what they wanted to do?
It was the early days, you know, because we also did the first Extreme music video. So in the early days, we got to tell them what to do. And it was just, they were like, look, we're happy to have some kind of a video created. It's a new thing. So great. But then once you get legitimate and you're working for the record labels, Sony, CBS, etc., they start to dictate. And I'll tell you, you'll be interested in this. Clive Davis sent me up to Taylor Dane's hotel room with a Polaroid camera. And I had a very specific agenda that she was to wear this outfit from the Tonight Show in the music video that we were doing. And this is one of the stories in the book, you know. I had to go up there and take all these Polaroids. She's trying all this stuff on, you know. And finally, I get that shot of you know, her in the Tonight Show outfit, send it back to Clive Davis. He circles it and says, this one. That goes back to her. Boom, that's what she's got to wear for the music video.
Did you know the music before you shot the videos for these people?
Yeah, no, they'd send us a song and we'd listen to it over and over and over again to come up with concepts.
And so the videos that you did in the early days of MTV had to fit the song line by line by line.
Well, that's what we were doing. You know, yeah. A lot of people weren't doing performance. They wanted, you see that gave me a Vegemite sandwich in a music video and someone hands them a Vegemite sandwich. I mean, they were getting very literal. It was actually kind of silly.
Yeah.
You know, and some of the stuff that we did, I look back at it, you know, stuff we did for Cool Moe Dee, and we had people dressed as robots and these kind of, you know, we didn't have big budgets. So the art department was trying to manufacture something that looked metallic, but was really just a lot of cardboard and spray paint.
How much time did you have to shoot a video in the early days? Like if MTV said we need something, did you have a month to do it, 2 months, or was it something that you churned around overnight?
Yeah, it was actually, you know, not from MTV. Everything was dictated by the record label. So they'd say, look, you know, we've got this artist. He's funny. He's skinny. DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince. Here's $20,000. Just do something so that we can get him on MTV. And you usually tried to time it when the single came out. So you got the singles released and the videos on MTV, you know, at the same time.
As you look back over the music videos that you did, are there any that stand out in your mind as that you're super proud of, and any of them that were successful that you went, wow, I wish I had done it different?
I would say the Step by Step music video, New Kids on the Block, it's the most successful video I ever produced. It was the hardest because we were on tour with them and I was line producing their home video, but trying to get them all together to do this music video. And at the time, the New Kids were fighting with each other. They didn't want to be in the same room. We set up a whole shoot. This is in the book, you know, we set up this shoot in Canada, flew people in from all over the country. And we got the call that, well, they're not coming. After we spent like $10,000 building this giant, you know, elaborate performance space. But we finally caught up with them in Los Angeles. And Mark, this was actually, you know, my childhood dream was to be in Hollywood making movies. That's what I wanted to do when I was 10 years old. I put that story in the book too. And then I find myself on one of those stages, you know?
Yeah.
And it cost $300,000, but we did this giant, elaborate music video called Step by Step. You can still find it online. Built a giant stage out of metal, brought in all these, you know, musicians and performers and dancers. So in the end, I really I'm pretty proud of the video. It really came out kind of like a little epic film.
So we got to ask you how you got to that stage where you were doing music videos. Where was David Horgan before that? And then we'll need to know all the many things, kind of road trip of some of the things that you've done subsequent, because your career's just been a fascinating thing.
I've done a lot of different things.
Yeah, where'd you start out? Where are you from, and where did you
get? Mark, I have a story of David way back when working with Erica Broman on the set of some Stanley Home Products kitchen in Holyoke or something.
Yes, I directed that.
I remember working on that shoot with you. I think I was a grip or an A2 or something like that.
That was with Fred Speckles.
Correct, yes.
Yeah.
I was working for Fred.
Yeah, Telecommercial Productions out of Agawam.
Correct, yes. So that's way back.
Yeah, that's when I came back from New York. See, I've told Mark, I work with inner city kids. And what I try to tell them is that I came from West Springfield. I had, you know, no money. I went to Greenfield Community College, transferred into Emerson in Boston, and did work study so I could help pay tuition. But it was the people I met in Boston. I put all this in the book. You know, Joel Stillerman, this is the guy who created The Walking Dead. You know, I was hanging out with him all the time. Scott Calvert, I met him at Emerson College. He's the one I did all the music videos with. And it was a process of our first two music videos winning MTV Basement Tapes that led to the whole New York thing. And I guess our timing was just good, you know? We were doing music videos at a time when suddenly it was exploding and every artist was getting a music video. So we were just, you know, going between New York, Los Angeles. And I almost got killed on one of the rap videos. And I said, you know, I've had enough of this. I'm going to move back to Western Mass. and everything was very different. You know, there's no music videos to be created in Western Massachusetts. So I got into medical education, did things freelance, Fred Speckles, right?
Yeah, I think our paths first crossed with Fred Speckles because I had just started my PR company in Big Y Foods, and Claire DeMore Daly had hired me to do a Welcome to Big Y video, which telecommercial filmed for me, and the Speckles and all that. And that goes way back, I mean, to kind of like the early days of using video and TV.
Yeah, and you know, for me, it was a big change. I came from New York, shooting 35 millimeter Panavision with a crew of 30, to Western Mass, shooting on video cameras and a crew of 2. And that included me. So that's what I put in the book, you know, very different world from New York coming back to Western Mass.
Well, we should probably talk more about the book and what's happened with Dave Horgan subsequent to the MTV music thing after we take a break to acknowledge the underwriters that make Arts Beat possible. But before we do, Dave, repeat the name of the book and how people can get their hands on a copy.
Yeah, the book's called My Real Life. I think I got it up here on the, I don't know if you can see it.
And it's on
Amazon. Yeah, Amazon. So you just go to Amazon, you type in My Real Life, David Horgan, and it's a Kindle and it's a hard copy. There's a guy named Mark Maitzel who did all of the creative artwork, laid the whole thing out. Guy is absolutely incredible.
Okay, well, we'll talk more about that when we come back after these underwriting announcements. You're listening to or watching Arts Beat here on Westfield Community Programming, Channel 15 or 89.5 FM WSKB. Peter Coles is our chief engineer this morning. I'm Mark Auerbach, and we will return after these announcements.
Underwriting for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield, serving the youth of the Whip City and surrounding communities since 1969. For more information on the Great Futures Club for ages 3 to 5, happening weekdays, and the Club Teen Center for ages 11 and older, weekdays from 6:30 till 8 p.m., go online at bcgwestfield.org or visit the club at 28 West Silver Street. The Boys and Girls Club of Greater Westfield. Great futures start here. Underwriting support for the community programming of WSKB is provided by the Greater Westfield Chamber of Commerce, the voice of business for the Greater Westfield communities. Informing, educating, advocating, the Chamber provides opportunities for members to make meaningful connections on local, regional, and state levels. For more information on the Chamber's many events, workshops, and programs, as well as the benefits of membership, visit westfieldbiz.org. The Chamber focuses on the most important economy, yours.
Hi, it's Bob Pless, and I have Wow, It's Tuesday, every Tuesday, 6 to 8. Wow, It's Tuesday.
Community Radio,
89.5 WSKB.
I did it!
Live from Studio 120 at Westfield Technical Academy, this is WCPC Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB Westfield.
Welcome back to Arts Beat, everyone. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. My guest today is David Horgan. And I have a difficult time describing Dave because he's a Renaissance man. He's a filmmaker and a videographer and a marketing guru and a teacher and all sorts of good things. But he's come out with a new book about his days filming music groups during the early days of MTV. Welcome back, Dave.
Hey. Good to be back.
So the book came out. So after you did all this MTV stuff and you came back to Springfield, what happened then?
A polar opposite. I found myself writing and directing medical education. So we created this series of medical education titles that somehow found their way to this entrepreneur building the whole thing up in a separate company and saying, look, we can make this into an IPO. So we all had, you know, stock. Everybody was worth $1 million when the IPO was coming. And it was just like, you know, watching the Wall Street or one of those movies, because everything built up. Yeah, we did this over the course of 4 years. Everything built up until the big crash of the NASDAQ. Do you remember that?
Yep.
So I, at the time, I had this stock that they said was worth $3 million. and we're sitting in a bar in Springfield. We put this, this story is in the book. We watched the NASDAQ crash. Next Monday, it was worth zero.
Yikes.
Unreal, right? So, and then it, somehow I went from medical education into political consulting. I started doing political commercials. So that, you know, that turned into a whole new career for me.
And you've done a lot of political campaigns over the years. How different is it making video and trying to put a politician out there in a variety in front of a variety of different faces as it is putting a musician up there and getting them recognition?
Yeah, I mean, in a sense, you know, it's very similar. We have, I think we're over 40 winning campaigns now. And I put this in the book, you know, what's the reason? Why do we have so many winning campaigns? One thing I always focused on was the humanity of the person. You know, it's one thing to have a politician, you can see him at a desk and delivering information. But I always like getting a shot of them with their family, reading books to the kids, playing basketball, you know, with somebody with a great football throw. And you throw that all in and you've got a person who hopefully you like. You know, and they've done studies that people tend to vote for somebody that they like. They're not always up on all the current issues, you know, what's really going on, but they look and say, I like that person. And that's, you know, what are you doing with a music video? You're trying to present this person, this group, and say, I like them, right? So it actually is a lot more similar than people would probably think.
So, but your political work, and I've seen a lot of it, is very within the parameters, so to speak. Nothing too edgy, nothing too stark, and nothing too edgy, but sort of in that middle of the road where your music videos just take it all over the map. Would you ever be able to, would any of your political clients go along with the idea of getting edgy, or do you kind of keep them middle of the road?
Well, I mean, like, you know, last summer was the Richard Neal campaign. And that was, you know, we did a lot of commercials. We did a lot of testimonials, real testimonials, what people thought about Richie and the job that he did. So certainly not edgy. If anything, it was more, like I mentioned earlier, the humanity. And that a nice thing about the campaigns we've run is we don't do negative. We've really worked with a lot of good campaigns that just, you know, we're going off their merits instead of attacking the other guy. So, you know, fingers crossed, right? It's I like doing the positive campaigns. I like working for people that I believe in, and so far so good.
Yeah. I mean, I have never worked on a political campaign. It was something, because of the reporting work that I do, that it just crosses too many lines. But I always got uncomfortable, and still do, seeing any political campaign that attacks somebody else. And your stuff is, I don't know how to describe it, but gentlemanly, it's polite in terms of the rhetoric that goes out there. And I would assume that that makes the political candidate more palpable in a campaign world where everything is vicious.
Yeah, no, it's what you'll generally find is that if someone is leading by 10 points, the other side has to do these negative attacks. And when the negative attacks come, they are brutal. You know, they are really nasty. And that was one of the things that bothered me about the attacks against Richie Neal, because I really believe in the guy. You know, he was, and I put this story in the book, he was a teacher in the Springfield school system. And that's where I teach. You know, I haven't for a while because of the pandemic, but it's the same students. And those are the students that my father taught. My father was a school teacher in the Springfield school system for really most of his career.
And I was going to say, the other part of your Renaissance man motif, so to speak, is the fact that you've worked with young people from all walks of life, teaching them video.
Yeah.
It's great that you're giving something back, but what is in it for you? What do you get out of teaching these kids how to make a video or how to express themselves? What do you get from it?
It usually comes around May when I get to see all these kids wearing graduation caps. And I do screenshots of them because I also have gotten a lot of messages that I didn't realize. You know, they'll say, that your media class changed my life. You gave me a confidence because, you know, you're putting kids on camera, they're singing, they're performing, you're shaping it, producing it properly, and really bringing out and highlighting the best of them, right? So when you get those messages about how much you improve their life, your media course was the greatest class I ever took, that kind of stuff is just, it's more rewarding than money, that's for sure. Yeah. Especially since there's no money in working with inner city kids. You really got to have your heart into it, because I don't care what people say, there's nobody really wants to give you that kind of funding that you need, you know?
Yeah. Have any of the kids at this point gone on to do media work subsequent to studying with you?
Yeah, and well, I would say a lot of my recent graduates, you know, what I'm seeing is that they're going to college, and some are going to college with some media focus as well. But there was a girl who I think she just got into Brown University, and she's coming out of the neighborhoods in Springfield. You know, she's the one who sent me this really nice note that the class meant so much to her and it really improved her confidence. So I do get to see them moving on, and you know, it's like I said, it's rewarding.
Yeah, you said that you weren't able to teach in person during the pandemic. Will you be able to go back in the classroom anytime soon?
Yeah, look what's going on, Mark. How can I tell? You know, they're just opening schools, and now you're seeing all these reports. I was just watching Holyoke did a live report about students getting infected. I don't know what's coming. You know, I don't know how they're going to manage this if you start having teachers and students getting sick with variants. So it's still up in the air.
Yeah. And I would assume it's very difficult to teach media online. I mean, I've done it in the last year. I've worked with radio with some of the students at Western New England and Westfield State. And Zoom is just not the best. I shouldn't say it's not the best way to teach media, but it certainly puts a lot of challenges out there that one wouldn't have if you could be face-to-face or in-person.
That's right. I mean, I've got a student who actually moved out of state, but she's been emailing me her raps that she writes, and I send her back suggestions, and we're going to arrange something so that she could perhaps record it at home and then send it to us, and then we could marry it to a track in a studio. You know, you can do a lot of stuff remotely now that's pretty incredible. But we all, we certainly miss the face-to-face. I just don't know when, you know, my course is not mandatory. So I'm at back of the line as far as, you know, getting that happening again in the schools.
Do you have a fixed location studio where you do your work, or are you pretty portable?
Well, you know, I work, the consulting work I do is right here. It's a small room in a condo in Northampton, you know. But my partner is a guy named Ed Brown at New York Sound and Motion. And all of our production happens there in the Mass Live building. And he's got the full studio, the lighting, editing facilities, et cetera.
So you're juggling a lot of things, despite the pandemic, juggling a lot of projects.
Yeah, right now I actually have five campaigns. The Stone Soul Festival, which if you saw any of the we had a lot of press in the Republican and Mass Live. And there's a guy named Edwin Lynch who's got an art opening September 11th at Pulp.
That's right.
And and then there's a music video for the guy who wrote Good Vibrations for Mark Wahlberg. And I directed that. And that video, I guess it's up to 20,000 views. Yeah. So a lot of different things going on. I can't complain, but, you know, definitely an absence of working with the kids. That's definitely something I'd like to solve.
How long did it take you to write the book?
I wrote that book, you know, I got a sublet in New York because I really wanted to get back to the city. And as I walked around, I took notes on my phone, you know, and then I'd go back to the sublet, which I sublet from a writer. This guy has like 150 books published. So in the sublet, you're surrounded by all these books. And I put this story in the book that, you know, I felt guilty every time I turned on this TV, you know, so I felt like I kind of had to do it. So to answer your question, I think it took me about 2 months.
2 months. That's
two months. And some of that was writing on the Amtrak, you know, which believe it or not. Yeah. Amtrak, I think is a great place for writing. I think that if you really want to get a lot of writing done, you should get on one of those things. You know, you can take Amtrak, I guess, around the whole country. I think you'd find that you can get a lot of work done.
Yeah. David, we're out of time, but I want to thank you so much for joining us. Tell us again the title of your book and where to get it.
It's called My Real Life, and you can get it on Amazon.
Terrific.
David Horgan.
Dave Horgan, thanks for joining us. And that wraps up another edition of Arts Beat TV and Radio here on Westfield Community Programming Channel 15 and 89.5 FM WSKB. If you missed a part of today's program or want to catch it again, it's archived on WSKB Community Radio's YouTube page. Peter Coles has been our chief engineer. I'm your host, Mark Auerbach. We'll be back next Friday with another edition of Arts Beat.
Never left a thing to chance. Stiffer than a froggy in formaldehyde. Now it's time to enjoy the ride.
What about the plans you made?
Plans are for sissies.
I've heard you'd never stray.
Just give me some kisses. Used to let my conscience be my guide.
Now it's time to enjoy the ride.
Effortless, effortless. This is so effing effortless. Ready to taste the things I've never tasted. Wow, your pants are
about being good.
I wanna be bad now.
Doing the things you should.
What are you, my dad now? Bring on all the fun that I have been